So, everybody, it's really a great pleasure and honor for me to be able to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Florian Willomitzer. He's a research assistant professor here at Northwestern in our ECE department. He directs the Computational 3D Imaging and Measurement Lab, the 3DEM Lab. Florian graduated from the University of Erlangen-Nuremberg in Germany, where he received his PhD summa cum laude. In fact, he won the Springer Thesis Award for Outstanding PhD Research associated with that work. During that doctoral work, he investigated the physical and information theoretical limits of optical 3D sensing, and he implemented sensors that operate close to those limits. I think we'll hear about some of those ideas here today. Now, here at Northwestern, he works with students and collaborators on novel methods to image things like hidden objects through scattering media. And as you've probably seen a few months back on the Northwestern homepage, around corners. He also works on high-res holographic displays and unconventional methods for precise VR eye tracking. So the group also developed some novel time-of-flight and structured light imaging techniques, working at depth resolutions in the range of 100 microns. So extraordinarily impressive stuff, and some perhaps budding applications in robotics and maybe even in haptics. So excited to hear his presentation today. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you very much, Ed. And hello, everybody. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to my presentation. So first of all, I have to say that I'm actually extremely excited to be invited today and to talk, you know, in front of this audience here. And this is mainly because I think, you know, that our research interests might have many interesting overlapping areas that I will be very happy to explore together with you today. So again, my name is Florian Willomitzer. I'm a research assistant professor, and I'm directing the Computational 3D Imaging and Measurement Lab here at Northwestern University, and today I'm going to talk about how to utilize fundamental physical and information theoretical limits to build better computational 3D imaging systems. And what I will do during my talk is I will show you the virtue of these limits at the example of our recent research projects. So obviously, this will not be the classic robotics talk, yeah, but I hope that I will be able to introduce you today to some novel 3D imaging concepts, and this might in turn, you know, lead to very interesting new applications for your robotics research. But before we actually start, I would first want to introduce our current team here at Northwestern University. So, because research is, of course, always a group effort, right? So this here is our current team here at Northwestern, where I work very close together with these people here on the top. And I should also say, since March, we all have a new addition, which we are all very excited about, of course. And together, we form a multidisciplinary team of faculty, which is advising a large cohort of students. Not all students, or not all of our students, are listed on this slide here. So here, you just see the students which are working together with me on my projects and which are co-advised or advised by myself. And on the bottom, you see a list of our external university and industry collaborators, which I want to give credit here as well, of course. So, this is an overview of our group's recent research projects. And even if the slide here is a little bit crowded, you can hopefully see that the broader field of research here is computational imaging, vision, optical 3D metrology, and 3D display applications. And the principles and devices which are developed here, they can be actually used in a multitude of fields. And this includes medical imaging, industrial inspection, AR/VR, and cultural heritage research. And also, they have some applications in robotics, of course. So think about autonomous navigation, robotic vision, or, you know, general perception tasks that just need a very high precision, or with very high precision requirements. Yeah, and also these projects, as you can see, span a pretty wide range between applied research and development and basic research. There's actually an overarching theme which draws like a red line through all of my research projects. And this is the thinking in fundamental limits. Or the question, where are those limits? And this is something that was introduced to me by my PhD advisor, Gerd Häusler, early on, and that I have continued since then throughout my entire career. And special interest here is given to the physical limits and the information limits. And you might ask the question now, why is this actually important? Well, this is important because the knowledge about limits prevents you from trying to make an unnecessary technical effort to build an impossible machine. And I have an extreme example about this for you. So think about the particle accelerator at CERN. This is an incredibly complex machine, right? And you do not want to invest money and effort in such a machine if you know that what you are trying to show with this machine at the end is physically not possible, right? And in turn, this also means that if you have a device which is already operating at the physical limit, then you can avoid unnecessary investments in better hardware. So what does this actually mean? So for example, for computational imaging, does this mean that, you know, you take your device and then you optimize it, make it better and better and better, and then at a certain point you hit a roadblock and then you are done because you hit the physical limit? Not necessarily, because, and this is also very important, limits often come in the shape of uncertainty products, like this famous Heisenberg uncertainty principle here. And such products actually make it possible to bargain with nature, for a better measurement of one quantity by trading off the precision of another quantity. And this already forms the basis for the physical optimization of your device. So, why are limits so important in imaging? And I also prepared a short warm-up example here that comes from classical imaging. So let's say your friend is a photographer and he approaches you as an imaging scientist because he says he is somehow unsatisfied with the resolution of his photos. Yeah? So he basically says that fine details in his photos cannot properly be resolved. And he approaches you because he thinks about, you know, buying the latest DSLR camera body with, 10 megapixel resolution. And he asks you, is this a good idea? And the answer is, you don't know. You don't know before you had a closer look at the system. And the system in this case is simplified as an objective lens and a CCD or CMOS chip here. And let's say after closer observation, you actually see that the blurring spot of a single object point is so strong that it's already spread, or so large that it's already spread over multiple pixels. Yeah? So in this case, the answer is it would not make sense to buy a chip with higher resolution because structures which are smaller than the blurring spot, they cannot be resolved anyways. Yeah? So what we have to do in this case is we have to swap the objective. And the way how an imaging scientist thinks about this problem is in terms of the so-called space bandwidth product. And the space bandwidth product, here only shown for the x direction, is basically defined as the image dimension w divided by the smallest resolvable distance in your image. And this gives you the number of independently resolvable points in the image, or in other words, the degrees of freedom. Now, and in our example, n, the degrees of freedom, is actually not the number of pixels. Yeah? N is actually smaller. And what I just told you already forms the basic recipe to optimize optical systems. So what you do is you identify the bottleneck of the information that flows through the system, and then you see how far you can improve this without hitting any physical limit. So this example that I just showed you was an example from classical imaging. Yeah? Some of you might be puzzled now a little bit what computational imaging actually is. And there are, of course, many definitions about that, and each of you who is maybe working in computational imaging might have a slightly different definition about that. Also depends a little bit if you're working more on the software side or on the hardware side. But for the things that I'm doing, I like the following definition. And this definition is that computational imaging takes the classical imaging pipeline, the conventional camera, and adds two very important components. Encoding, which can be done with the illumination or an optical mask, and decoding, which is done with an algorithm. And what is decoded here is the information that reaches the sensor to evaluate the final result. And whoever here in the audience is a little bit familiar with information theory might actually see a striking resemblance to Shannon's transmission model for communication systems. So this model basically describes how source information is, where's my cursor, is encoded so that it can pass the noise affected channel without too many losses. And then it's decoded on the other side where the information should be delivered. And what is so striking now is that we can describe a computational camera as communication channel as well. So for example, if our computational imager would be a 3D camera, yeah, then the object surface information would be encoded, and then it's transferred through optics and electronics, and then it's decoded with an algorithm that finally calculates the 3D image here on the other side. And it's also well known, I should say, that the most crucial component in such an information channel is actually the encoder. And the encoder, this is the role of the illumination. Yeah? So the illumination serves as source encoder for the information, and this allows you to see something with your computational imager that you would not see otherwise. And this can be actually very powerful. And the textbook example, or I would say a very impressive example, at least for me, is always a bright field, dark field phase contrast, which you might know originally comes from microscopy, but similar methods are also used nowadays in CT imaging or X-ray imaging. And let's see what this is. So you probably cannot see this, yeah, because the contrast is so bad, yeah. But this is an image of some cells. And the magic of illumination encoding is now that if you observe the same object with the same camera and just slightly change your illumination encoder, then you can actually go from this image to this image. Wow, right? So what does this tell us actually, or what do I want to tell you? I want to tell you that choosing your illumination modality wisely, this can obviously lead to very powerful improvements, and these improvements are also important later for the processing and the decoding, yeah, of your data. And I have to say, this insight plays a very important part in my research as well. So for today, I plan to talk about three subsets of our research projects, and these subsets are our triangulation measurement principles, and then after that, I will discuss our reflectance-based imaging principles that we developed for the handheld measurement with commodity devices and for precise eye-tracking applications. And at the end, I will discuss our synthetic wavelength imaging systems that recently received a lot of media and popular press coverage, mainly because we can do something with them which is very fancy, and this is imaging around corners and through scattering media with submillimeter precision, I should say. Yeah, and we start with the triangulation-based principles, and one of them here, the single-shot 3D movie camera, this is indeed working at the limits of physics and information theory. And why is that? This is because this sensor provides a dense and precise point cloud that can also display high object frequencies in each camera single shot. And to understand why this is actually so special, we first have to take a look at the state of the art. And if we do that, we see that all state of the art 3D sensing principles have at least one severe weak spot. Time of flight cameras, which are used in many approaches, have typical depth precisions in the centimeter range approximately, and this is too imprecise for many applications. And for triangulation, or these structured light principles that I will focus on now for this part, we have here methods that rely on a temporal sequence of exposures, yeah, where the object has to remain perfectly still during the whole acquisition sequence. So these methods are obviously not motion robust. And there is another class of triangulation principles, and this class uses all kinds of spatially coded patterns, like for example this dot pattern that you have in the first generation of the Microsoft Kinect sensor or in the Apple Face ID sensor, for example. And the drawback here is that you need spatial bandwidth to read this code somehow, spatial bandwidth on the chip. And this introduces an inherent low-pass filter on the data, and this makes it impossible to measure fine structures of the object. One principle that does not have this problem is, or these problems, is multi-line triangulation. And multi-line triangulation actually works by projecting a narrow line pattern onto the object and then observe this pattern with a camera under a triangulation angle. And then from the deformation of each line here in the camera image, you can calculate a nearly perfect 3D profile. So this principle is single shot, and it preserves high spatial resolution, but only along each line. Yeah? And between the lines, there's obviously much space, and this makes a dense surface acquisition impossible. So obviously, there's no free lunch. Yeah? But this problem actually seems quite easy to overcome, right? I mean, just project more lines. Yeah? But it actually turns out that if we look more close at existing multi-line triangulation approaches, then we see that these approaches are not able to project more than 10 or maybe 20 lines in the very best case if no codification is applied. And it actually turns out that this problem is not just a technical problem, this problem has a fundamental character. Namely, the more lines we project, the harder it is for us to distinguish between the lines and to find out their right number or their right index. And this is especially true, oops, if the object contains these high surface frequencies, like these jumps that you see here. Yeah? And if we draw that on a piece of paper, we actually see that the line density is limited by two parameters, the unique measurement range, delta C, and the triangulation angle, theta, which defines the precision of our method. And ideally, what we want to have is we want to have large values for all these three quantities, line density, unique measurement range, and triangulation angle. But we can already see that this is not possible because what we have here is an uncertainty relation, right? And what happens if we ignore this relation and project too many lines on purpose, we see here on this slide. So what happens is that the unique measurement range shrinks and we get these typical indexing ambiguities that can be seen as these jumps here in the data. And solving this ambiguity problem in single shot and without wasting spatial bandwidth actually bothered our group for a very long time. And before I show you the solution, which is actually quite simple, but before I show you the solution, I show you a pretty nice workaround that we came up with. And this is our measurement principle, flying triangulation. So I should say now that this is the first of a number of videos that I show now. And from my experience with Zoom, I can actually tell that these videos will look very choppy over Zoom. And this is the reason why I always give the link here on the bottom so that you can watch the videos again in high quality. So this is was a comment for the Zoom people. So what we see here is that we still only project sparse lines. Yeah? But as soon as the measurement starts, now the measurement starts, we have a hand-guided sensor that acquires a series of sparse data after another. These sparse data are then registered to each other in real time. And at the end, we have a dense 3D model, which is composed of many registered sparse single-shot 3D models. Here for the dental scanner with a precision below 30 microns. So obviously, this works quite well, right? But it's already clear that this is not the full solution, yeah? Because this solution is already robust against rigid object motions. Yeah? So if we would measure, for example, a talking face instead of a dental cast, then we would have heavy motion artifacts here. So this means that for the single-shot 3D movie camera, we have to really tackle this indexing problem now. And for this, we revisit our uncertainty relation that we already know. We keep the line density fixed. And remember, we want both of these yellow quantities here as high as possible to get correct indexing and high precision. And the question is now, how can we get that? And the answer is, I say it right away, the answer is angular multiplexing, or in other words, additional angular information, which is captured by a second camera. So what we do is we add an additional camera, and then we combine both cameras in a way so that one camera encloses a very small triangulation angle with the projection to generate the large measurement volume, and the other camera encloses a larger triangulation angle with the projection to generate high precision data. And the information of both cameras is then combined with an algorithm that we call the index back projection algorithm. And unfortunately, in the interest of time, I have to skip this one because this would make like a 30 minutes talk for itself, but I'm very happy to come back to this in the discussion if you are interested. And I directly jump to the captured data. So this is a 3D model of a human face. Some of you might see that this is my face. Yeah? And as you can see, this 3D model can be freely watched and like turned and watched basically from every perspective, yeah? Basically like a hologram. Yeah? And since this 3D model is now really acquired in single shot, what we can do is we can simply acquire many single shot 3D models after another, and then we end up with a movie of 3D data points. And this is how it looks like. And this video here shows a zoom in the 3D movie. And I have to emphasize that I always show the raw data here of the sensor. Yeah? So there's no post-processing, no interpolation applied. Each point that you see here is an individually measured 3D point with high precision, 200 microns on human skin in this case. And remember, because we don't have pattern codification or because we don't have spatial correlation, we are also able to see the edges, yeah, of objects. So the edges are nicely preserved that we can see here in this kind of folded paper accordion experiment. Okay, so I introduced you now the basic principle. Now let's talk a little bit about the limits, the information theoretical and physical limits. Should we allow questions now, Ed, or should we wait? Yeah, so I didn't understand the question. In principle, this is only dependent by the camera that you use. So for these measurements, I used a camera with 30 frames per second. So pretty standard, actually, right? And I will have later, actually, a nice video that goes directly back to your question. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this was maybe a little bit too fast. So the problem is with Apple's Face ID, that in Apple's Face ID, you project like this pseudo-random dot pattern, right? And then what you do is you kind of have a kind of template and you want to match this template in the dot pattern that you have, right? And you do this, you can do this, for example, by correlation, yeah? But the basic thing is that this needs some space on your chip, yeah? So this needs some spatial bandwidth, and this introduces a low-pass filter on data, and so you cannot measure any more like fine frequencies, like wrinkles, for example, in your face. Yeah? This is the main difference of this principle, or like I would say pixel dense principles, to all these principles that are using all kinds of patterns. Yeah? I mean, Apple Face ID is not the only one that uses pattern codification. Yeah? But this is always the problem with these pattern codification methods, that you always pay a price, and the price that you pay here is spatial frequencies that you cannot resolve, okay? So, for example, if you have a pattern codification method, you would have a very hard time to measure these sharp edges in the paper, okay? Okay, so now let's talk a little bit about the physical and the information theoretical limits, and I will make this one very quick. The first limit we discuss is the limit of the distance precision. And as I said, I will jump over most of this because this goes like very deep into optics and speckle theory. But in order to improve the distance precision, what you do is you need to perform a physical optimization of the so-called speckle contrast. Don't worry if you don't know what this is. What is important for you is that we perform this optimization, and eventually we experimentally evaluated the distance precision, and we got values between 200 microns and only 17 microns in the very best case here. And you can actually calculate theoretically that this is very close to the limit of what is physically possible for these kind of multi-line triangulation setups. And the second limit I quickly want to discuss is the limit of the line density. So I think all of you will believe me if I say that the lines have to be separable in the camera image. And this separability is basically dependent on those three factors that you see here. And to save you again from all the math, I directly jump to the result. So we calculated that the theoretical maximum of parallel lines that can be projected for a 1 megapixel camera is 160. And it turns out that our sensor also operates at this limit, meaning that we can really reach this number in our setup. But actually, it turns out that with a very simple engineering trick, you can nearly double this number again. And this is by the projection of a crossed line pattern. So the gag here is that you can even achieve this without adding additional cameras into the system, only by a slight displacement of the two cameras that are already in the system you can achieve that. So in fact, what we are doing here is we create four triangulation sensors with only two cameras. And this is then how such a 3D model with crossed line patterns look like. And in the zoom in window here, you see how dense the object is sampled here. So each point on each line here is an individually measured 3D point. And with this, we can acquire nearly a third of a million 3D points in each 1 megapixel single shot. Yeah, and last but not least, we also evaluated our principle under information theoretical aspects. And I also just briefly mentioned this here. So what we did is we started at the information theoretical model for 3D sensors, and then we used Shannon's channel capacity to come up with an information theoretical figure of merit that can be used to quantify different 3D imaging principles. And we call that channel efficiency. And I need to direct you to my PhD thesis here for detail, because I will not explain what all these terms mean here now. But the basic construct is output information in form of the 3D model divided by input information in form of the 2D images that we have. And what comes out of this estimation is that our sensor performs around 8 to 10 times better than other single-shot principles, like, for example, Apple Face ID. And it basically reaches the same performance as the multi-shot principle phase measuring triangulation. And phase measuring triangulation is known to be the gold standard in terms of efficiency, but we have already seen that phase measuring triangulation is not motion robust because it's not single shot. Our method is. Yeah? And yeah, before I move on to the next topic, just a very quick side note. So of course, we can also do this with color cameras as well. So this here is the image of the prototype here, where you see the preview of the 3D model on the screen. And this is then how such a colored 3D movie looks like. Still raw data, no post-processing. And I think many people in the audience can actually imagine what you can do with a 3D sensor that outputs this kind of data quality. Yeah. And this is the last video that I show for this research track, which shows now the real-time capability. This goes back to your question now. So even if we use slow cameras here that are working only at 30 frames per second, we can still image this jumping ping-pong ball without any motion artifacts. And this can become now very important for the 3D inspection of fast processes, like, for example, crash tests or bullet impacts or exploding airbags or medical motion analysis and so on and so forth. Okay, yeah, and with this we move on. Oh, question, yeah. Yes, this is still a constant, but this would actually be my answer to a question that you maybe want to ask. So these very fast processes, right? So think about a flying bullet, for example. How can you still do that? Because the, you know, the exposure time of a camera can be very short, but it cannot be indefinitely short. Right, and how you can do that is actually with pulsed illumination. Yeah. So this would be the next trick that you can play in order to image very, very fast processes. This was still with constant illumination. Yeah. And like, but very short exposure time. Yeah. So that's important. The frame rate was 30 frames per second, but the exposure time was quite short. Yeah. Yeah, correct. Yeah. Okay. Thanks for the question. And with this, I think we can move on to the next research area. I have to be careful that we stay in time here. So So the next research area is our reflectance-based 3D imaging principles. And I will do this one now a little bit faster to make sure that we have enough time for the last research area. So reflectance-based 3D imaging. So we actually first developed this research track for a very important cultural heritage application. And this was to measure 3D structures in stained glass and then map these structures to a glass manufacturer, basically like a fingerprint, yeah, to track their provenance. And maybe some of you might know that there is always a big problem with the measurement of specular surfaces, because most systems use light or use light sources where the light basically comes from one point, yeah, and hence will probably not find its way back into the detector. And these problems already start, you know, if the object is not fully specular, but for example shiny or wet, yeah. So think about wound measurements with assistive robots, or think about, you know, robotic surgeries on the open heart, for example. Yeah. And then you can take a step back now, and then you can think a little bit why you are actually able to see specular objects at all, right? Because if no light from the object hits the camera, then specular objects should be invisible, right? So let's take a stroll through Chicago and find out. So what you see here is the very famous cloud gate in Chicago. And I think everybody of you can see that it's shaped like a bean, right? And this is exactly the reason why many Chicagoans call it the bean, correct? So obviously Chicagoans are very creative. Yeah? But actually, the big question is, why do we actually know that it's shaped like a bean? Yeah? Because I just told you that specular objects are invisible. Yeah, we can tell the shape because our brain uses prior information about the environment. Yeah? So our brain knows that the horizon that we see here should be horizontal, and that these skyscrapers here, they should be straight, and so on and so forth. And we use this prior information to actually calculate the shape of the object. So the answer to our dilemma is, again, proper source encoding. Yeah? Or in other words, pick your light source smart. In this case, make it an extended screen with some kind of pattern, yeah, and then observe the reflection of this pattern over the specular surface of the object with a camera, and then from the deformation of the pattern in the camera image, you can calculate, in this case, the surface normal. And this is the basic principle of deflectometry, and deflectometry is just another textbook example for very powerful source encoding. So with $500 equipment, approximately, you can measure specular surfaces down to the micrometer or even sometimes the nanometer. So this is very powerful, yeah, if you do it right. And what we did is we basically developed a handheld deflectometry system for everybody that uses the screen and the front camera of commodity devices like tablets or mobile phones or something like that. So here you see some results for the stained glass measurement. And for better angular coverage of the whole thing, which is actually very important for specular objects, for better angular coverage, we applied a freehand guided registration algorithm. And this basically allows you now to take multiple measurements from different perspectives and then to synthesize something like a virtual dome. Yeah? And this is the result for this virtual kind of dome measurement. And in this case, it's stitched together from 14 different single views. And yeah, this is how it looks like. So that was the application for the glass. Yeah? But we actually thought that there is even a greater potential in this idea. And the greater potential to this idea is that you can basically turn every modern media device in a high-quality 3D sensor. So for the people listening here over Zoom, for example, this would even work with the computer screen and the web camera that everybody is staring at right now these days. And the logical consequence to that was that we extended the principle also towards matte surfaces or matte surface measurements. And here we have mainly explored two ideas. First idea was to use the system to measure the face of healthcare workers to fabricate these snug-fit COVID masks. And the other idea that we explored was an application in teledermatology where the 3D data can actually help to detect skin melanoma. And here are just a few results on human skin. So here you have the 3D model of fingers, and this is a normal map of a human face. And we also measured fingerprints, and you can actually, I mean, look at your fingerprints here. You can actually see how nice these depth profiles here of the fingerprints are actually resolved by this method. And I should also say that for an art preservation application, we also measured very popular paintings, which showed a mysterious form of degradation. It basically looked like acne-like structures. And because the painter was so famous, I mean, many of you might know Georgia O'Keeffe, this was actually received by the media pretty well, as you can see here on this slide. Yeah, and the most recent thing my group is doing in this direction is in collaboration with Facebook Reality Labs. And the project here is to use the dense and precise measurement that deflectometry provides you for a completely new and precise eye tracking method in virtual reality headsets. And the basic idea here is that, you know, state-of-the-art eye-tracking methods, they sample the surface at 10 or maybe 20 data points. Yeah? But if we use deflectometry for that, for example, with a 1-megapixel screen and a 1-megapixel camera, then we have like 1 million data points on the eye surface. Yeah, and without going into detail, you can actually see that we use normals of this dense surface representation here to extract the center of the cornea and the sclera, and then to use that, and then we use that to estimate the gazing direction here. And I should also say that in parallel, we are also exploring other methods that are deep learning based and methods that use inverse rendering. But unfortunately, you know, time is much too short to discuss all this in detail, of course. So this is all current work in progress. But I think I can already say that our first experimental results are actually looking very promising. Basically, it looks like we can reach very small gazing vector errors, but this has first to be confirmed with more experiments. Okay, so this was yes. Hi. Yes. This is one of the problems that the cornea and the sclera are a little bit different from reflectance-wise. So the sclera is more of a volume scale. Right? This is one of the problems we are currently working on. Okay. Yeah.
You gave some examples, like the fingerprint where the surface was not specular. So how did that work?
So this is a little bit different. It's not quite deflectometry. The method is a method that is closest to photometric stereo, if you know what this is. And it actually turns out that deflectometry and photometric stereo are very related, actually, right? And the overall or the future goal is basically to combine both of these things in like one, yeah, you can call it app if you want. Yeah? So in one app that you have on your mobile phone or whatever. Okay, thanks for these questions. Yeah, so that was basically the elevator pitch about all the reflectance-based principles. And again, this showed us, you know, how important proper illumination encoding paired with sophisticated algorithms really is. And the last research area I'm going to show you today is actually another textbook example for this. Yeah. So now we move on to the synthetic wavelength imaging principles. And here I will mainly talk about synthetic wavelength holography, which is a novel method to tackle the new and exciting problem of imaging around corners and imaging through scattering media, and like fog or skin, for example. And I have to say that this goes now a little bit into wave optics, yeah? But I always try to paint the bigger picture here, so please bear with me if you are not so familiar with wave optics. Okay. So this slide here is basically a kind of teaser slide that shows the future potential of this research area called non-line-of-sight imaging and imaging through scattering media. So the promise here is that if you would have an optical sensor that could look around corners, yeah, then you could detect obscured objects on curvy streets, or you could build a kind of optical endoscope to detect detect defects in running machinery. So these are only a few examples, of course, but basically what you want to do here, and this is very important, you want to turn walls into mirrors. Yeah? And for imaging through scattering media, on the right side, the promise here is that you could, for example, monitor the beating heart through the breast, or you could look at brain vessels through the skull, all without using x-rays or an MRI or something like that, basically just with visible or nearly visible light. And if you take a step back now, and if you think a little bit deeper about both of these scenarios on the left and on the right side, then you realize that both sides here share exactly the same problem. And the problem is on both sides that light is basically scattered in all directions, yeah, and completely loses its spatial structure during the scattering process. Yeah. And I have to say that people actually came up with the idea pretty quickly that instead of spatially structuring the illumination, like we have seen in these structured light principles before, yeah, people should look at the time of flight of the light. And what this means is they basically measure the path lengths that the light travels from the source to the wall, to the object, back to the wall, and then back to the detector. But the thing is, we already know that these so-called time-of-flight cameras, which are used in many state-of-the-art approaches, by the way, they cannot always satisfy the resolution requirements. And this is mainly because of limitations in silicon manufacturing technology, and this restricts the minimal possible modulation wavelengths, which is, as you can see, directly proportional to the depth error here. And the smallest wavelengths that you can achieve for these kind of time-of-flight cameras is on the orders of tens of centimeters, and this results in a depth error of around 1 centimeter, approximately. There are alternatives for that. On the other end of the spectrum, there is another well-known time-of-flight principle, interferometry. And as some of you might know, interferometry is not using an intensity-modulated light source or a pulse. Interferometry is using the oscillations of the physical wave light field itself. So it works with very small optical wavelengths up to several microns, and it's very precise, up to nanometer precision. And the problem is, I mean, there's always a problem, right? So the problem is that interferometry cannot be used in scattering regimes, and this is mainly because the very small wavelengths lead to a phenomenon that is called speckle, yeah? And this speckle phenomenon now completely scrambles the optical phase that you would need to calculate the time of flight information of the light. Yeah? So ultimately, what we need a wavelength that is larger than optical wavelengths. Oops, now I spoiled the surprise here. So ultimately, what we need a wavelength that is larger than optical wavelengths, but smaller than time of flight wavelengths. And you already saw how it is done. This can be solved, this problem, and this huge gap that we see here can be filled by exploiting principles that we know from dual wavelength interferometry. Yeah? And this is exactly what we do in our approach. So in this approach that I will introduce you now, we exploit encoding at different optical illumination frequencies. What does this mean? This means if we superimpose two lasers, or if we mix two lasers with slightly different wavelengths, then we produce a high frequency wave with a low frequency beat note. And this is something that you might know from physics class in school, yeah, where it's normally demonstrated with the sound waves of two slightly different tuning forks. Yeah. And we do this here with light waves. Yeah. And with special detection methods, we are actually able to electronically isolate this beat wave and thus to create a low frequency synthetic wave. And the synthetic wave can be now freely chosen, yeah, depending on the two optical wavelengths that we choose here. And we can use this encoding and decoding method now to perform time of flight measurements at the synthetic wavelengths, and the synthetic wavelengths can be chosen orders of magnitude smaller than time of flight wavelengths. And this works simply by putting both lasers together at both wavelengths in an interferometer setup, and then measure the reflected speckle fields at each wavelength. And as I said before, these are the speckle fields, yeah, and as I said before, the phase of each of these speckle fields, yeah, which you can basically un- light information. Yeah? So this is how the face looks like. And you can actually see that the face is completely scrambled and reveals no information about the macroscopic pathings variations at all. Yeah? Now comes the trick. Things change now if we take these two fields and if we synthesize this correlation term here. And this correlation term, as you can see, contains the difference of the two phase maps. And this term is now particularly interesting because if we look at the phase of this term, we see that the phase actually does show a clear structure, yeah, and is not speckled at all. And this is the phase map of the synthetic field. And what is in fact happening here is that the microscopic phase perturbations at each single wavelength, they cancel each other out. And at the end, the phase map contains only the macroscopic pathings variations, which are on the order of the synthetic wavelengths. And here you see the corresponding phase maps and also depth maps at different synthetic wavelengths for a real measurement. Here the bust, as you can see. And for our precision evaluation here on the bottom, we achieved for the smallest synthetic wavelengths that we measured a depth precision of only 35 microns. And again, commercial time of flight cameras have a precision of about 1 centimeter. Yeah. So this was the high resolution time of flight camera. Remember, this was only one application of this technique. Yeah. What we actually want to do is we want to use that to image around corners and through scattering media. And this works now by performing holography at the synthetic wavelengths. And I will also explain you in hopefully very simple terms how this works. So what we do here is we shine light at the two wavelengths towards the scatterer. And in this case, the scatterer can be a wall, it can be a diffuser, it can be a cloud. It does not really matter here if the scattering is happening in transmission or in reflection. Yeah? Then the light is scattered, and then we have these two speckle patterns that illuminate the object. And then the rough object surface creates another speckle pattern that again hits the scatterer. And after the last scattering process, we have these two completely scrambled wavefronts again. Yeah? And what is typically used to characterize this scrambling of the wavefronts is the so-called wavefront aberration, psi here. And this psi is now much, much larger than one optical wavelength. So what we do is we capture again the two speckle fields and the two optical wavelengths. Then we calculate again this correlation term that I have just described, and then we end up with a hologram of the hidden object at the synthetic wavelengths. And again, the face of the synthetic hologram actually does show a clear structure now and is not speckled at all. And what we do now is we simply perform a numerical holographic backpropagation at the synthetic wavelengths, and by that, where's my animation? Here. And by that, we obtain a reconstruction of our object. So backpropagation is a wave optics term, yeah? But you can actually think about this as a time of computational reconstruction, which assumes a known physical model. And in this case, the known physical model is the model of wave propagation. Yeah, yeah, and we did this here for the non-line of sight geometry, where we project a laser on the wall. And then we image the returned latent field from the hidden object with a camera. And important to mention here is that both camera and light source, they cannot directly see the hidden object, which is in this case this very small cutout letter N here. And to speed a little bit up, I directly jump to the results, which are again captured for different synthetic wavelengths. Yeah? Again, the phase maps of the synthetic hologram on the top and the reconstructions on the bottom. And what is actually so fascinating to see here now is that the synthetic wave actually behaves much like an optical wave. And what I mean by that is that the resolution actually gets better with decreasing synthetic wavelengths. Yeah? But also you see that the measurements at smaller synthetic wavelengths are more susceptible to this kind of degradation that you see here. And this degradation of the result paired with the improvement in resolution actually begs again the question, are we approaching a fundamental limit here? Or in other words, how small can the synthetic wavelengths become? And we calculated this and we found that the synthetic wavelengths can actually not go below 4 times the maximal wavefront aberration psi, which is introduced here by the scattering processes on wall and object. And just as a side note, this is actually a limit that is pretty well known from classical optics. It's called the Rayleigh quarter wavelength criterion. And it's like actually pretty interesting and pretty striking here that this criterion is also true for the synthetic wavelengths. Yeah? And the synthetic wavelengths, I have to say, is of course much, much larger than the optical wavelengths now. And because of this, it can tolerate also much more scattering. Okay, and in order to estimate the performance of our system now, we can use again the space bandwidth product that we already know, and we end up with this expression here, which is again an uncertainty product, yeah, now between the width of the field of view that you can see around the corner and the resolution that you can achieve. And on the right side, you have two system constants, the wavefront aberration that we already know, and this here is the size of the area on the wall that you observe. And as I said before, this is now very important, a unique feature of synthetic wavelength holography is now that we can dynamically adjust our synthetic wavelengths to different scenarios with stronger and weaker scattering. And by that, we can always approach this theoretical limit that I described here very close. And this can be nicely shown in the next experiment, which is the last experiment that I will show for today. So here we image through scattering media in a transmissive setup, and the object is now this small cutout letter U here, which is hidden behind two scatterers, as you can see here. And what we do is we image first through a ground glass diffuser, and later we image through a milky plastic plate, which is basically comparable to, I don't know if you know that, like these cutting boards here where you cut your onions on. Yeah? You can already see that the information of this checkerboard pattern behind this cutting board here is completely scattered out already. Yeah? But nevertheless, we are able to nicely reconstruct the object. Yeah? In both cases, as expected, the milky plastic leads to larger wavefront aberrations, yeah, which means that these measurements deteriorate faster. But these measurements through the diffuser are also very interesting. And why are they interesting? Because the diffuser is a known part with a known grid size, it has known dimensions. And this means that for the diffuser, I can now calculate the wavefront aberrations. And our first order calculations actually show us that these wavefront aberrations that you can calculate for this diffuser, they are indeed about a quarter of 280 microns. Yeah? And indeed, you see that this reconstruction here is actually shortly before deteriorating. Yeah? So this means that this measurement is actually very close to the absolute limit of what is physically possible. And I should say that we know from other resolution experiments that this measurement is actually or reaches submillimeter resolution. Yeah, and looking around corners or through a scatterer with a submillimeter resolution is something that you would have a very hard time to do with classic time-of-flight based approaches. And I think in the interest of time, I stop here. I just quickly want to say that our recent publication of this in Nature Communications actually created a large amount of national and international media coverage, also in quite popular news outlets, as you can see here. And if you're interested, this is everything collected here on this webpage. And I guess what I really want to say with this is that this topic obviously is of quite interest for the public. And we hope that this helps us to successfully continue on this path, yeah, and to keep exploring, you know, all these interesting problems and follow-up questions to these problems in the future. Yeah, and that's basically it for today. To summarize my talk now on a very high level, I would actually like to show a slide that I adapted from my PhD advisor, Gerd Häusler. And this is the canonical model for an optical sensor. So we have just learned that such a sensor is always composed of a light source, the surface that we want to measure, and an optical and electronic system, like a camera and a computer, which evaluates the information. Yeah? And we also learned that the illumination is actually very important, yeah? And that we have many modalities that we can choose from here. Yeah? So coherent, structured, pulsed, polarized, you name it, basically. And for all these illumination modalities, the object actually looks different and reveals different information. also the interaction with the surface plays a role. So you can have specular reflection, incoherent volume scattering, and so on and so forth. And finally, we also have to decide which modality we want to observe. Is it intensity? Is it frequency? Is it time of flight? And so on and so forth. And now comes the gag. All these possibilities sum up to over 8,000 possible sensor embodiments that everybody of you can invent. What does this actually tell us about computational imaging? I mean, first of all, this tells us that computational imaging is a vast play field that brings you a lot of fun, and I hope that I was able today to show you how much fun it is to work in computational imaging, actually. But this also means a little bit more. This also means that it's actually super important to understand and even exploit the limits, to pick the best sensor for your application, to get the best possible performance of your method. And this is now really the end of my talk. So today I took you on a journey and I introduced you to different 3D imaging principles and systems which might or might not have direct applications in robotics. I think for many principles that I showed you, it actually might be the case. Yeah? Unfortunately, I did not get a chance to talk about all the other projects that are going on in our group. I hopefully can do this in the future at a different occasion. And what is left to say now is that I hope that I was able to also convince you today in this talk that limits are not always a bad thing, especially if you know how to exploit them for the optimization of your device and for bargaining with nature. And if you want to know more about our work, please write me an email or have a look at this website here in the research section. And I'm looking forward to your questions now. We have 2 minutes left. And I say thank you for your attention.
So now I'm going to pass around the microphone for any questions that are asked. What do we have today?
Thank you very much. For the last part of the research, do you need to first put a mirror, let's say, to calibrating the scattering medium, or they cancel out each other just naturally?
That's a very good question. So I try to say it as simple as possible. So let's keep with the example of imaging around the corner. Yeah. So theoretically, you saw that you always need something like a wall, right, to image around the corner. So you cannot direct light around the corner, right? You always need an intermediate surface, and indeed, this surface does not have to be flat. It doesn't have to be a flat wall. It can also be, theoretically, it can also be a car or a human or something like that, right? But then you actually need to know the shape of the surface. And this would be in other words, you can say you need to calibrate the surface. The good thing is that our sensor that we use to image around corners is already a very precise time of flight sensor, right? So the idea is to use the time of flight sensor first and measure the surface, then you have calibrated the surface, and then you use the same kind of sensor. You need to change the illumination a little bit, but you can use the same kind of sensor to image around the corner.
Huh? Yeah, other questions? We have, yep, I'm going to get back there. No, you worry.
So for the synthetic wavelength stuff, is the mixing like actually physically performed, or is that like done as like multiplication and post-processing?
That depends. There are like many, many different ways how you can do it. Yeah, in the paper, in the Nature Communications paper, we applied a log-in camera, and I don't know if how much you know about that. So we had heterodyne detection. Yeah, but in principle, on a high level, you can also just capture the two speckle fields separately at the two wavelengths and then mix them together computationally. Yeah? So you can, it really depends on the hardware that you have and how you want to do it. And also a little bit the time is also the question. Yeah?
More, okay.
I was just curious if you ever looked into like deep water and whether any of your methods, whether you tested in deep water situations.
Yeah, that's also a very good question. So for this method, or like for these results that I showed you today, we still captured two sequential images. So one image at wavelength one and the other image at wavelength two. What you require for this is that between capturing these two images, nothing moves, yeah? Because you strongly rely on the correlation of your two speckle patterns that you capture. So right now we are working on, but this is not published yet, but we are working on a single shot method where you can capture the whole thing in one single camera frame, and then this it will be possible to also, you know, image through this dynamic scattering media like fog or like muddy water or something like that. Yeah. But I have to say, you know, we are really just at the beginning of everything. Yeah. So imaging through dense fog is actually a very, very hard problem. Yeah, I mean, we image here through some cutting boards, so, right, so we are still a little bit away from imaging through very dense fog. Yeah.
Any other questions? Yeah. The hand I saw.
This is more of an open speculative notion. Can you talk a bit more about categories of scatterers? Because it seems like the fundamental mechanism of this of the synthetic wavelength method is that the change in the path length is small compared to the synthetic wave. So that would be true for simple scattering,
yep,
and not a simple and modest scattering, where if you have multiple scattering, that severely changes the angle and as well as the path length,
yep,
you're going to start running into limits.
Yeah,
so
and
there's some kinds of scattering for which that are much harder than others.
Yeah, and the main problem to that is, I think this is not the answer to your question, but I say it nevertheless. So the main problem is that actually when you have like very severe and very strong scattering, then actually the synthetic wavelength becomes very large. Yeah? Because we have seen that, right? The size of the synthetic wavelength is dependent on the severity of scattering, and this can become very large. And then again, your resolution takes a hit. And this is the reason why we are currently exploring other methods that put some additional flexibility to that. So right now we are discussing, for example, about applying time gating. So time gating is something that is already used when we talk about imaging through scattering media. But what is normally gated out is the purely ballistic photons. So the photons which are not scattered at all. And you can think about, I mean, if you have fog and you gate out the ballistic photons, this is like a terrible signal-to-noise ratio, right? Because the number of these photons is actually very low. So what we talk about and think about right now is that we could, for example, also not only gate out only the ballistic photons, but the photons which are a little bit scattered, like just a few times, because we still can process them with our synthetic wavelength approach. And this will give us an additional knob to turn on, right? So then we have an additional knob that we can use, and then you have again trade-off, right? You have then trade-off signal-to-noise ratio versus synthetic wavelengths. Yeah. I was probably not answering your question, but it was probably still interesting. Yeah. Yes. 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 So we are working on it.
Okay. One last question. Thank you for sharing this really beautiful body of work. I was just wondering, my understanding of a lot of medical imaging applications is that the allowable dose is closely related to the wavelength, and that's related to how dangerous it is to send those signals through the body. So do you think that in doing this synthetically, you're able to break through some of those previous barriers?
Yes. And the wavelength is actually very important. I mean, I don't know so much about medical applications right now. I just know that, you know, if you have, for example, this is a method that is called diffuse optical tomography, right, where you actually want to look inside the head. And for this method, it's actually very important which much optical wavelengths you use, because it's kind of, it's a question of penetration and all this stuff. Yeah? And it's just very nice, like in this, like with this respect that you just said, this synthetic wavelengths trick is just very nice, because it decouples your carrier from the measurement wavelengths, right? So your measurement wavelengths is different than your carrier wavelengths. And this gives you like a lot of opportunities.
All right, we've had some great questions and got a bit over time. So let's thank Florian for a terrific talk.